To be here. Thanks everyone for coming. I am a particle physicist, so I thought we might try this in three parts. First, try to define what particle physics is. What is it that we're trying to do? And then second, I wanted to talk a little bit about the tools that we use in the field. How do we go about trying to answer the questions that we have? And if the slides work, that's when we would show some pictures. If not, that's okay. I'll be able to describe things, I think. We'll see. And then finally, I wanted to spend some time talking about the Higgs boson. That's a particle that I spend most of my time working with my students right now, trying to characterize it. We discovered it in 2012. I know that's starting to feel like a long time ago. People say, what have you done lately? The truth is, it's been a lot of work trying to understand the particle after discovering it. So that would be the last piece of it. But I want to start with a question that I find very interesting, and that is, how is it that the moon knows that the Earth is there? We know that the moon orbits around the Earth, right? So how does the moon know that the Earth is there? Anyone familiar? I mean, why is it that the moon orbits around the Earth?
Gravity.
It's gravity. Exactly. Gravity. Okay. So the good news about gravity is that we have a description of gravity in terms of how the force behaves mathematically. If you tell me what two masses are and how far apart they are from each other, we can calculate this is the force that they will feel due to gravity, right? And this is how they will behave because of gravity. But that's a little bit different. The ability to predict and to understand mathematically and model, that's a little bit different than understanding why, what's the mechanism, how is it that the moon knows that the Earth is there? Or for any of us, how is it that our bodies know that the Earth is there, right? If we jump, we're pulled back down. We can ask this question about all of the forces that we've discovered. We know about four fundamental forces. And the question in particle physics is, what is the mechanism? How is it that a positive particle and a negative particle know about each other and are attracted to each other, right? Electricity and magnetism. We have gravity, electricity and magnetism, the strong nuclear force, the weak force, four forces we know about. For each of them, we'd like to determine a mechanism. The particle physics answer to these questions is that there's communication. If the moon is orbiting the Earth, there must be an exchange of information between those two things. For my body and the Earth, there has to be some kind of exchange of information. How does my mass know about that mass? And in particle physics, you're not surprised maybe to hear that we think of that exchange through particles. In electricity and magnetism, the force of repulsion or attraction is communicated through photons. There's an actual mediating particle that's involved in terms of communicating that force. Gravity is an interesting one. We haven't actually found a quantum theory of gravity. We haven't incorporated gravity yet. But we posit, we think, that what's happening is gravitons. We've named the particle. We haven't found it, but we've optimistically named it. Gravitons are flowing between the objects that are interacting through the gravitational force, and that's how the communication is happening, okay? So what does particle physics want to do? It wants to understand all of the fundamental forces. What are the basic building blocks of the universe in terms of fundamental forces and fundamental particles? And we really want to understand not just what's a mathematical model for gravity or for electricity and magnetism. We've had those models for a long time. But what's the mechanism? What actually makes that work? How is that information communicated? Okay? Does that make sense? I'm going to pause here and see if people are happy with the particle physics picture.
I don't understand the whole... I mean, I conceptually understand graviton, but what are its properties?
Yeah, so we know some things. If the graviton exists, we know some things about it. So what are the properties of a particle in general, right? The particle might have electromagnetic charge or not. It might have some mass or not, right? It might have a lifetime. It might be a stable particle, or it might be a particle that decays. There are other characteristics that we look for, the spin of a particle, other kinds of things that I think are harder to wrap our heads around without quantum mechanics. But for those basic things, the graviton, if it exists, would have to be a neutral particle. It would be a massless particle. We have evidence that the force of gravity is communicated at the speed of light. So let's say that a big star sort of appeared out of nowhere, you know, above us. The force of gravity wouldn't instantly be felt by us. That force would take amount of time that it takes for light to travel to get to us. I'm going to get back to this later when I talk about the Higgs. That means it's a massless particle. Neutral, massless particle is what the graviton would have to be if it exists. Sort of similar to the photon that communicates electricity and magnetism, and that we see, right, that is a neutral, massless particle, travels at the speed of light, that communicates that electromagnetic force. Sometimes, you know, this is an interesting debate that goes on in physics. The particle physicist's obsession with particles, and then the idea of fields. Is it a field description of nature or a particle? Maybe you've heard about electric fields, magnetic fields, gravitational fields, right? So a particle physicist is okay with the idea of a field. That's fine. But tell me what it is. You can't just say, oh, it's a field. I need more information. You know, we're looking for the quantized, the piecemeal nature of that field and how that communication happens. Okay, so what are the fundamental building blocks of the universe? Those basic particles that come together to make up all the matter that we know, and how do those things interact? Always keeping in mind the fact that we ask the next question, but how does this thing know that thing's there? Okay. Yes.
You're using the term know. Is it really know, or is it just experience by the force?
So
you're using a term that says it has knowledge.
Yes, and that is probably not a safe, that's not a safe term to use. It personifying particles, right? Giving them agency of some kind. But the reality is you can know something in your brain. You know, as humans, the way that we experience those things is to feel them, right? So for example, if I'm going to interact with someone and you're going to make me move and experience a force, you can't just sort of stare at me. Well, maybe you could, depending on your expression on your face, right? But if you chuck a basketball at me, I'm going to rebound. There's going to be some momentum. And that's an interaction, right? Fundamental forces of nature might be repulsive. You can chuck a basketball at me that sort of makes me come back when I catch it. Or attractive. You chuck something at me that makes me come toward it, right? But the bottom line is there needs to be flow of information. Now, you could say, is information as a word any better than knowledge? There are big debates in physics about the nature of information. But the mechanism is the piece that we're looking for. There is information exchanged. There are particles involved. There is something that goes from this one to that, from me to the Earth, from the moon to the Earth. Does that make sense? Yeah. No, when I say, you know, how does the moon know that the Earth is there? You're right. I'm not talking about the moon's brain. I'm talking about some kind of information exchange, some kind of interaction between those two things. Yeah. Okay. That brings us to... see if we have any luck, because what I'd like to tell you next is a little bit about the tools that we use. And this is one of the best things. Yes, it should be here. If I reload this, And here it is. If this recognizes PowerPoint, there are a lot of big ifs.
Yeah.
Okay. This isn't perfect, but it may actually work. All right. So my research happens at two locations. A lot of our information is communicated by data that's shared everywhere. But there are two laboratories where I do a lot of my work, primarily at the Large Hadron Collider, which is outside of Geneva at CERN, an international particle physics lab that's been around since 1954. And I also have a research component that's at Fermilab, which is right outside of Chicago. I'm going to talk mostly about the experiment at CERN, which is where we discovered the Higgs boson in 2012. CERN is so large and complex that it's taking a very long time to load. It is the place where we're making the highest energy collisions that have ever been created by humans. So at CERN, if you look 100 miles underground, 100 meters underground, that's an important distinction, 100 meters underground, we have a 27-kilometer tunnel, so 16, 17 miles around, where we have protons circling. And we accelerate protons buried underground, you know, around this huge ring. If you think about it, that's pretty big, 16 kilometers around. And we get those protons moving very close to the speed of light, and we smash the protons into each other. And then we take advantage of Einstein's E equals mc squared, and we say, okay, nature, we just gave you a lot of energy in this collision. We're going to look and see what comes out of the collision and actually use what comes out of this collision to help us understand what are the fundamental particles in the universe and how do they interact, okay? So big collisions, lots of energy. There's a saying people have, you know, if you ask a particle physicist, how does that watch work? A particle physicist will say to you, well, can you give me maybe 20,000 watches? And then one at a time, they'll chuck the watch against a wall and watch how things bounce back. And they'll pay careful attention about how things sort of mount. Or they'll chuck the watches together. They'll make collisions. And you'll look. And by understanding what comes out of those collisions, you can start to piece back together what happened inside. Not a very efficient way to understand how a watch works, but a reasonably good way to try to understand fundamental particles in nature. So what makes this work? Well, the fact that we're very, very high energies, one lens you can look at is a time machine lens. We're going back to very soon after the Big Bang in terms of the energy density that we have access to. So we're able to look at particles that were created and that existed at the Big Bang at very high energies that, you know, and very high masses that aren't around us in abundance now. So it's a time machine. Lets us go back in time. Or it lets us see, again, because of the incredible energies that we have, a lot of very massive particles that we don't necessarily have access to otherwise. Okay, so we're hunting. We're going hunting for particles that we haven't yet seen. They're too massive for us to have found in earlier experiments. Aha! And I can show you a couple of pictures. This isn't perfect. I apologize. I'll make it big. It's a little better. Wow, isn't that nice? I don't know if people can really see these at all. Okay, we can turn it back on in about 4 minutes. I just want to show you a little bit. So this is an image overhead. And you can see the Alps on one side and Lake Geneva right here in the middle. I first moved over to this part of the world in 2006 when I was a postdoc and joined the Atlas experiment. And we lived there from 2006 to 2010. It turned on for the first time, the Large Hadron Collider, in about 2009 with real data taking in 2010. And we've been going with a couple year shutdowns essentially ever since. I was out there again in the 2021-22 academic year with my family when we started running again after a period of time. So you can see this red line that goes around. That's mapping out the 27 kilometers or 17 miles that the Large Hadron Collider takes up. The CERN accelerator complex is actually a lot more complicated than just that last Large Hadron Collider ring. What we do is we have a series of different colliders, and the cool thing about it is, if you look at this ring here that injects into the Large Hadron Collider, this used to be the highest energy ring. And before that, this was the highest energy ring, all right? So we don't get rid of the former highest energy rings. We actually use that to feed the next machine. And it's remarkable, CERN was started in 1954. We have some really old pieces of both linear and circular accelerators here that are still part of the overall chain, that we, you know, get to a certain energy in one stage and then go to the next stage with the protons and get them going even faster, and then the next stage until they end up in the Large Hadron Collider. In this last ring, the Large Hadron Collider, there are multiple places where we're smashing protons into each other. And you can see those in these yellow dots. So you wouldn't necessarily believe ATLAS, the experiment that I work on, if we said we discovered a Higgs boson that looks a certain way. But if ATLAS sees it and our partner experiment, CMS, sees it, then maybe you'll believe that we've actually found something. It's nice to have multiple experiments that are working to try to make sure that what we think we're seeing is something that's real and not a fluctuation. Yeah.
You said something about still using the old ones.
Yeah.
And can you just repeat that, because I'm not sure.
Yeah. So imagine reversing in time before the Large Hadron Collider existed. Okay. The SPS, this ring right here, was the highest, was the last ring. That was a ring that was producing science. We were using that. I wasn't using that because that was used, you know, I don't know, 80s or something before this tunnel was dug. But that used to be the machine that we used. And if you go back in time even further, the complex didn't have the Large Hadron Collider. It didn't have SPS, but it had PS. Okay. This is the machine that used to be the highest energy machine, right? What we do in particle physics, because we want to keep going to higher and higher energies so that we can explore territory that hasn't been explored before, and that has allowed us every step we've taken to discover something new. But in order to do that, if we want to get the protons getting even closer to the speed of light that we smash into each other, we actually need the bigger ring. And I could go into that in more detail if people are curious, but there are lots and lots of details about how this works, and I don't want to get too stuck on it. I do want to show you, because I have a hard time with 27 kilometers, what does that mean? This is a long time ago. My husband and I sitting on the looking out at the Grand Canyon. This is a map. People been to the Grand Canyon? This is a map of the Grand Canyon that shows you the Large Hadron Collider on there. I think it's safe to say that the Large Hadron Collider is about the scale of the Grand Canyon, if you think about how big this machine is right now. And actually, they're talking about in 2045, so a long time from now, making a machine that's a 90-kilometer ring. We'll see if that happens. So, where we have these collisions, you want to understand what comes out of those collision points. Deepti, you asked about what is the nature of the potential graviton, right? What is its mass? What is its charge, right? What's its lifetime? What's its spin? These kinds of characteristics. So if I want to go hunting for a new particle, I need to understand everything that came out of these collisions in order to know if I've seen something that is expected or unexpected. So if we have collisions of protons at the center of the machine, we can have hundreds of particles streaming out. And our goal is to understand everything we can about those hundreds of particles that stream out. So imagine that we wanted to catalog people. We wanted to understand you know, the nature of people, everything about them that we can. What we might do to be super efficient is form a line here. And one of us in line would be the first person. We'd ask, you know, what is your name? And then the next person in line might ask, you know, where are you from? What's your hometown? And the next person in line might ask, well, what's your family? And then the next person, what are your favorite foods? What's your educational background? What are your career goals, right? You could imagine, to be super efficient and careful, if we wanted to catalog people, having a line of us that everyone passes through and gives information to, all right? And by the time someone's gotten to the end of that line, we've collectively built up a really nice picture of, you know, information about that person. Particle detectors work very similarly. People describe them as onions. There are these layers that have different jobs. What do we want to know about particles that fly through? We want to know the charges. Are you charged? What's your energy? What's your momentum? If you do have charge, are you positively or negatively charged, right? What's your mass? Lots of information that we're trying to extract from the particles that fly out from our collisions and pass through the detector. And so does that make sense? If I've got a detector that's got these different colors that are layers, my particles come in, they collide, the protons collide, lots of energy there, maybe hopefully creating new particles that stream out. The particles that stream out of that collision have to pass through all these layers of detector on their way out. And you can actually show this, I like this image of it here. If you think about the particles that start at the beginning of this, you know, in the center of the detector and have to make their way out, they pass through these different kinds of detectors. And what's cool, sorry about the escape full screen.
Is that really the scale of the human being next to it?
So that tells you my thesis experiment, CDF, was about that scale. I'll show you Atlas is 6 stories high. It's the largest detector that's ever been created, actually, and the most massive, yeah. But this is a particle detector from the 90s, very compact, like what I did my thesis experiment on. So what's neat about this? The details aren't too important. These are different kinds of particles, and what you see is they interact with all these different layers in different ways. So it's a detective game. And we actually, my students and I, will work on writing computer code that takes our detector signals and basically tries to identify the particles that came through based on how they interact in all of the different layers of the detector. So it comes down to that kind of detective work. This is what Atlas looks like. That's the experiment where I do my work. And this, like I said, is 6 stories high. It is the length of a football field. It weighs as much as the Eiffel Tower. And it has hundreds of millions of electronic channels. And I find it very interesting that we needed the biggest detector ever created in order to study the smallest things that we know about, right? The thing is, the particles that we create at the center of this detector in these collisions have so much energy that many of them are moving at or near the speed of light, okay? And so it actually takes a detector that's really massive to handle particles that are moving that fast and characterize them and get the information out that we need, all right? But you can see that it's buried 100 meters underground. I don't know if people can read the text there, but the Atlas name, I like to show the name history a little bit, because I think it's the most tortured acronym I've ever been associated with. I don't know if you can see that it's a toroidal, so we grab the T. LHC is an acronym, so we put an acronym in the acronym, and then apparatus, we grab the S from the N. So people clearly, you know, developed the acronym before figuring out how we would make it fit into the name.
What is the material this 6-story structure is?
What is this material made of?
Yeah, the primary.
In here?
Like cement?
No. Let me see. I've got some pictures. So this is zooming into Atlas a little bit. You know, it's funny. I have a collaboration with a dancer at Yale. Yeah. We've taught a class together. We've written a book together. And I brought her to CERN. And I took her down to see the Atlas experiment. And she got down there and she looked, I mean, you can't see very much of it because it's all kind of packed in, but her reaction was, she said to me, "It looks like you guys went to Home Depot." is what she said. So it's not like chrome and blinking lights and, you know, very fancy. No, it looks like it's budget, and it's mostly cables. You can see the different components, pieces of it, maybe in layers, lots of different ones. I'm sorry, I keep getting those. But this is a picture. So see this? These are the people right there. This is one of the wheels, okay? You can see this wheel right here. So what is it? There's aluminum, there's steel, there's copper, there's wires. There's in the center of our detector, there are silicon. There's a lot of silicon detectors. We've got gas, different kinds of gas chambers, gas tubes. There are magnets, there are electric fields. There are all of these different components that allow this detector to give us a view. This is the ATLAS detector. You can see here a person. Before, much of it was inserted, but it shows you these big toroidal magnets that are spanning the outside and lets you see a little bit. So this is a story here. It lets you see a little bit of the scale zooming in. And this is a picture of a smaller scale near the center of the detector. We have really detailed, tiny detectors that are giving us very good information about tracking the particle paths. You can trace a path of where the particles go throughout. And that's where a lot of our electronic channels come from. This is something that my group has worked on quite a bit. You know, we have these collisions that actually happen 40 million times a second when we're taking data. There are all of these numbers that are really intense and crazy, hard to wrap your head around. So yeah, we have up to 40 million collisions a second. And we're not seeing them with our eyes. You can't see what's happening here, right? These particles aren't all photons. They're not creating flashes of light necessarily. But what we're doing is we're capturing signals from the detector. People talk about ATLAS like it's a great big camera taking a photo of the collision in some ways. That's one way to think about it. But this is one of the ways we represent a collision and show what happened. So it's basically taking a cross-section of the detector. This is a real collision that we took on July 5th in 2022. Protons were coming in and then particles were streaming out. And what you see in orange here are lines of some of the particles that we discovered. And then these little blips here are energy deposits that happened in different places in the detector. So we call this an event display, and it gives you a nice visualization of what happened inside one of these collisions, okay? And this is a cross section. This is basically looking at the can. You know, the detector is kind of like a can, and that's looking at one of the sides and seeing all the particles streaming out from the center. But most of the work that we do with these is done through our computer programs. We have algorithms that we develop that do the detection. I spend a lot of time working on the trigger of the experiment. So we have 40 million collisions a second, but we can only keep 1,000 collisions a second. And we have to make decisions very quickly and programmed in to understand if something's interesting or not. So this is the ATLAS control room. This is me in, I think, 2006, and this is me in 2022. Different color hair, but nothing else has changed. Yeah. So
just a second, Sarah. So yeah. Off the 40 million, you have to select 1,000.
Yeah. Yeah. And we do that in different stages. Make the easy decisions quickly, and then take more time with the later decisions. And we have buffers, pipelines, so we can store the data for a period of time before we have to get rid of it. We just couldn't possibly store all of the data for all of those collisions. And it's not all interesting. Mm-hmm. And I could defend that.
So what are you doing when you're sitting there? Are these collisions?
Yeah. Here I'm eating. That's what I'm doing there. And that actually, I think, is one of the things that got me into particle physics. As soon as you've got away from any radioactive sources, you can eat, unlike chemistry and biology, where they usually don't let you. So here we're monitoring the detector. We're looking at event displays like this right here to make sure that there aren't any dead sections of the detector. We're monitoring the safety, the voltage levels across the machine. It's expensive equipment. We have to make sure that everything is going according to plan. We're making adjustments if something changes with the beam quality and we have to make an adjustment on our side. We have, you know how I talked about the layers of the detector with the different steps that have different jobs? So each of those layers has a desk here where people are monitoring that particular detector component to make sure that it's working well. If there's a problem that comes up, and problems come up all the time, we want to be on it as quickly as possible. So we have a lot of stuff that's automated that checks and will, you know, tell us if something's wrong quickly. And then you need a human to react to say, this is something we can fix. This requires us to stop taking data and really fix it. The collisions are precious, you know, so we don't want to lose any more data than we can. And we have a competitor. We're running at the same time that CMS, that other detector, is running. And so we don't want them to end up with more data than we have so that they can make discoveries that we can't. So there's a lot of pressure to make sure that we're good stewards of the data. That's a lot of what we're doing.
So there's is this thing running continuously? And is there someone always sitting at your console?
There is someone always sitting in that control room. I mean, so CERN, it's interesting. CERN shuts down over the New Year's Christmas period. That's because electricity in Europe is most expensive at that time. There's not a lot of air conditioning that's happening. There's a lot of heating that happens in that part of the world. That's the most expensive time for electricity. At Fermilab, where we also have particle accelerators running, it's different. We shut down at Fermilab the month of August. Because that's when electricity is most expensive because of all of the air conditioning that happens outside of Chicago. So there are some electricity cost reasons that dictate we're going to be shut down for a period. We try to run in a given year from about the beginning of April through mid-December at the Large Hadron Collider. It takes a couple of months to get things up and going. When we're running, it's 24/7. With the understanding that, okay, there are, you know, breaks that have to happen if there's something that they need to fix or something. But the goal is between April and, you know, end of November to be 24/7-ish. And it doesn't matter if it's 3 o'clock in the morning or three o'clock in the afternoon. There are people who are on shift who are, monitoring that.
And it's not like telescope time where your lab will book
It's not. Okay. It's not. We all share all of the data that we collect and all of the fights. So in a telescope, people argue about where they're going to point it. Yeah. I mean, argue is the wrong word, maybe. That's harsh, yeah. Right? But they discuss, where are we going to point this thing? For the large for our data, we discuss how we design what we call the trigger. Which kinds of events are we going to keep and which kind are we going to throw away? That's where all the debates happen before we start running, and then we share the data set, and everybody has to do their science with it. And we've had over 1,000 publications come out of Atlas since 2010. So we have many, many, many different searches that people are doing with this data, measurements and searches. Okay, it's a collaboration where institutionally, we have 235 institutes in 38 countries. You'll see that there are some gaps in terms of our coverage with countries, and that's something that the collaboration is working hard to improve. If you just look at the nationalities of our members, you find that we have a little bit better coverage over the world. But it does make it a challenge to schedule meetings when you've got people. We're in every occupied time zone, so there have definitely been periods of my life where I was a 4 a.m., 3:30 in the morning, you know, CERN at 9 a.m. is 3 a.m. here on the East Coast. It's a real benefit to be on the East Coast rather than the West Coast, and sometimes you just have to go to CERN if you want to get some sleep. Okay. So I know that I can't do justice to this kind of equipment in 15 minutes, but I just wanted to give you a sense of the scale. Incredible complexity, huge teams. One other piece of information I should give you, there are 5,000 of us who are on the Atlas experiment, okay? So it takes a lot of us to keep this detector up and running and to analyze the data and to build it. So I think there might be other questions about this. We can come back. But I think it would be fun to talk about the Higgs boson. We can turn the lights back on. And I can stop the... maybe we can leave a nice picture up. And I will try to... I do try to make sense, and I don't know if I do make sense anymore. So I apologize for that. But this next piece, I would really like to make sense. So I hope that people will stop me if I don't make sense. And this comes to the question of mass, okay? So the story, I want to go back to the 1960s. In the 1960s, there was a solid understanding in particle physics that, and you know, when did particle physics officially start? I don't know, we could debate. But there was a solid understanding in physics that some particles had mass and some didn't. They knew about the photon traveling at the speed of light and other particles like electrons, just for example, okay? Mass in particle physics actually is very closely tied to speed. So when I hear that a particle is massless, has no mass, what that communicates to me is that it travels at the speed of light. It cannot slow down. A massless particle has no choice. It is stuck, always moving at the speed of light. So mass, in terms of a fundamental particle, really means it's slowed down. And the question that that physicists had at that point was, what is slowing these fundamental particles down? Why isn't everything zipping around at the speed of light as massless particles would? The problem became when they tried to insert mass into their mathematical models, because you've got a description mathematically of how particles are behaving, how they're moving, and they tried to insert mass into their models. And were unsuccessful. Every attempt they made broke something else fundamental. One thing that they broke at one point with one attempt to insert mass into their models was Einstein's special relativity, right? Okay, we're not gonna break that. That seems to work. So Peter Higgs and a number of his colleagues had a revolutionary idea for mass. And here's the idea. What if mass is caused by a field that's everywhere in the universe, and we just haven't discovered it yet? And it's like some particles zip through that field and don't see it, but other particles, the ones that have mass, when they're trying to move, they're like in molasses, and that field is slowing them down. That's the basic idea, okay? So there's a field everywhere in the universe, we haven't seen it yet. Some particles don't interact, they just go right through, but other particles do interact and have those, and they can't travel at the speed of light. So it was a terrible, terrible idea, because you do not posit a magical field that exists everywhere in the universe that no one has yet seen to explain something that you can't explain, right? So if I lose my keys, the best scientific explanation probably would not be that a field exists that ate my keys. We haven't found the field. You can imagine why physicists did not like this idea. It's a last resort idea to say, I'm going to explain it by something that's everywhere that nobody has seen. And to make it worse, I don't know if you've heard the story of the ether. Has anybody heard that story? They used to think of the ether being, that's a road that people had gone down before and been wrong, right? And how embarrassing to explain everything by this field. So Peter Higgs, who had this idea, trying to sell it to people, it was so bad that he was in the UK. His postdoc got a job offer in the US. In North Carolina. I don't remember what institution exactly. And then the postdoc realized, oh, I can't take that job offer. And Peter Higgs said, maybe I'll have better luck in America. And so he contacted the department and he said, you know, my postdoc can't take that job, but I would love to come and take that job. And the department said, well, we're not going to pay you any more than we were going to pay the postdoc, even though Higgs was more senior. And he's like, that's okay. I'll take a pay cut. I just want to see if I can get anybody to listen to me. Eventually, they let him give a talk in the department. But he, I mean, it was a real uphill battle for him to try to convince people this might be the explanation for mass. Okay. So the question that we have then is, how do you go about looking for this field? How do you know if the field is there or if it isn't there, right? Because that's the fundamental question. Is this really an explanation for mass? And for that, I'm borrowing a good friend of mine, Mike Hildreth's explanation, which I think is really beautiful. Okay, so imagine that you're sitting on a canoe out in a lake, and it's a very still, calm day. If you reach out over the side of the canoe and you hit the surface of the water, what will happen?
Ripples.
Ripples, right. You'll have a splash. There'll be something that sort of comes out. Ripples will emanate. We would call that an excitation, okay? And this seems a little odd to say, but the reality is, if there were no water, you wouldn't get the ripple. You wouldn't get the excitation, right? So at the Large Hadron Collider, the way that we try to make an excitation of the Higgs field is by smashing particles together. And if we give it enough energy, we can actually create that excitation that is a particle, the Higgs boson. And the reason the Higgs boson is exciting, not because of the Higgs boson itself. The Higgs boson is evidence that the Higgs field exists. Okay? The Higgs field is the explanation for mass. So people had, since the 1960s, been going to higher and higher energy machines looking for this particle, right? Are we going to see it? You know, no, we haven't seen it. No, we haven't seen it. What was exciting about the Large Hadron Collider is we knew that we had access to a huge new energy range. We were either going to see this particle, or it wasn't the kind of particle that Peter Higgs and his colleagues had said would exist. Okay, so we did find the Higgs boson. It's behaving in terms of how it decays exactly the way it should if it's this particle that exists. And that means that particles that have mass, fundamental particles that have their mass because of that coupling to the Higgs field. As far as we understand it, we now have a mechanism for mass. We understand the mechanism for how it works. It's because of this field that we weren't aware of before Peter Higgs thought that it might be there in the 1960s.
But what is the boson?
The boson is a particle that when we create it, lives for a very short period of time and decays away to other things. It's a particle. It is an excitation in the way that a ripple is an excitation on the water. It carries energy. It has mass itself. It's a particle.
So we all exist in this Higgs...
Higgs field is everywhere.
Field.
Yeah. It hasn't bothered us much.
And say again how you identified it.
Yes. Yeah. That's really important. So the thing that makes the Higgs field special, and it's different from anything else we've interacted with, is that it has a different level of coupling or of interaction with different particles. So what do I mean by that? The electron has one mass, and a muon, another fundamental particle, is much more massive. The Higgs field is special in that it couples more with the muon than it does with the electron, right? The things that have more mass have a stronger interaction. So if what we have found, if what we have created is the Higgs boson, we should see that it decays most to the more massive particles and less to the less massive particles. We had a very crisp prediction for the ways that the Higgs would decay. Okay? So when we went looking for the Higgs boson, what we do is we get enough data so that we can see that there's something that's been created that has a certain kind of mass, okay? The Higgs happens to be 125 GeV-ish. a certain mass. And then when we look for that particle, we can see the way that it decays, what kinds of other particles it decays into. And the Higgs follows exactly those predictions that we had. It decays the right fraction of the time to muons, to taus, to W bosons, to Z bosons. It's amazing. It follows exactly the prediction that we would expect if it's coupling more to the more massive particles. So it walks like a Higg, it talks like a Higg, it quacks, you know.
Now all the 5,000 people that are working on your thing can see it, you know, any afternoon they want?
So we have made thousands and thousands and thousands of them at this point, and we have done very detailed analysis. I mean, in early days, we saw this bump. We saw evidence. It looked like there's something there, right? CMS happened to see it too, and then we took more and more data and it became more and more pronounced. Every year we have another one of these more rare decays that we have access to, and it just keeps behaving and behaving and behaving the way the Higgs should. Now, let me tell you that that fact is in some ways a great triumph, right? In some ways, for Higgs in particular, it's a great triumph that this idea that explained a problem we had in a mathematical modeling actually turned out to be the right explanation. That's amazing, right? In other ways, it is very, very, very depressing. It is terrible news, because what the Higgs field does is give us a mechanism for mass. It lets me tell you how particles get mass, as we understand it. But it doesn't give us a fundamental insight into why an electron has one mass and a muon has another. And that's a much more interesting question in some ways, right? When we look at the fundamental particles that we've seen, we have a spectrum of different masses, and they're orders of magnitude different. Some of them are tiny and some of them are huge. And we don't know why, and maybe it's just because that's the way that it is. But this, you know, field that we discovered in 2012 that has apparently always been around, it's a mechanism, but it doesn't take us much further in terms of getting insight. You would think or hope that your explanation for mass might lead you to gravity, and a better understanding of gravity, and the Higgs boson doesn't help us with that.
Does it interact with gravitational fields, magnetic fields?
That's what makes so the Higgs is coupling to mass. The Higgs itself is a neutral particle. Both neutral and charged particles, if they have mass, they can interact with the Higgs. Was that your question?
So the Higgs field is everywhere.
Yeah.
And so does it interact with gravitational fields and magnetic fields? And if I have a magnet here,
right,
and I have iron filings going, you know, the standard textbook thing, where's the Higgs field?
It's talking to mass. It's just interacting with, it's just talking to fundamental particles and giving them mass. It's slowing down some particles, and it's slowing down some particles more than others.
So what creates the excitations?
So in the example of the Large Hadron Collider, we smash its kinetic energy. We have protons that we smash in a certain location. We give enough energy to the Higgs field, more than the mass of the Higgs boson, so that we can create the Higgs boson. It doesn't actually make sense. I mean, that's my favorite thing about physics, is that the more you learn about how things actually work, the more committed you realize that, wow, okay, this sounds sort of nonsensical.
How can we, the rest of humanity, non-particle physicists, benefit from this knowledge?
Yeah, that's a great question. The field of particle physics came out of the group of people that developed the atomic bomb. So if you look at the early days, I mean, particle physics is funded out of the Department of Energy still, primarily, which is interesting. Though the Office of Science and the Department of Energy funds a lot of things now, right? There was a turning point in the 1970s when the Fermi lab director, that lab outside of Chicago, went before a congressional hearing and was asked, how is the Tevatron that he wanted to build, how is that going to help defend our country? Because that's what particle physics was good for. That's why they kept everybody employed, right? Keep the particle physicists employed. We want them in this country because they're going to make the next bomb, right? And he answered, it's not going to help defend the country at all. It's going to make the country worth defending. So the answer is that I don't know how the Higgs boson will affect people. I think that, you know, one of the reasons I attempt to talk about it as much as I do is because everybody owns it. Everybody owns the discovery. Something like 92% of the world's taxpayers contributed to discovering the Higgs boson. So I wouldn't be here at a science cafe if I didn't think that it was a common good that all of us should get to celebrate and maybe have some access to. When the electron was discovered, I think there was probably no sense that it would revolutionize the way that we live our lives. It has, right? I don't know if the Higgs will or not. The one piece that is fundamental is the development of the World Wide Web. That was so that particle physicists could share information easily. That was, you know, what how it was started. That's right. The development of superconducting wires so that hospitals can all have MRIs, proton therapy, PET scans, all of that. A PET scan is a particle physics detector. It's photons coming out that you can use the same techniques that we do to find it. So medical diagnostics, medical imaging is using what we learn as we learn how to detect particles and work with particles. But, you know, at this point in our society, you know the really strong shrink wrap that's on turkeys? That's been treated with a particle accelerator. Rubber in tires, we use fewer chemicals now because we treat the rubber with accelerator beams. So particle accelerators are everywhere in the economy. So we have done those sort of studies of, okay, how do we help the economy? How are we helping society? But the bottom line is, it's producing knowledge. We're learning. You know, the goal is not the next bomb. The goal is, what are the fundamental particles of nature? How are they interacting with each other?
So I have what There's might sound like a really silly question, but I'll go after because I've been asking so many questions. Someone else want to?
I think there was
question?
Yeah.
We can throw this question away. I didn't do my homework this morning, but in the last couple of months in the Science Times of the New York Times, there was an article that was sort of saying some discovery recently was somewhat questioning the Big Bang theory. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yes. No, I do. And that I would say is in the realm of astrophysics. There is a period that is still not well understood of inflation. There's an accelerating expansion of the universe that's baked into the Big Bang. And there are different measurements of the Hubble constant, which gives us information about the accelerating expansion of the universe. We have things that aren't in agreement. So the James Webb Telescope was the latest to give us a measurement that shows tension with different measurements. Yeah, it's not directly my field, but astrophysics and particle physics are asking a lot of the same questions. Yeah.
So my question is, particles go through this particle accelerator, they decelerate, right? What is that? What's happening there?
So we load up the Large Hadron Collider with a bunch of protons, actually bunches of protons, and then it's billions of protons in each bunch that we pass through each other. We do not have the ability to steer two protons into each other. No. We have to get such dense bunches of protons that, and then hope that a bunch of them are going to interact when we steer these bunches through each other. Okay, so it takes us 20-ish minutes to do the last step of acceleration. We load them into the Large Hadron Collider from the SPS, the last machine, right? And they accelerate. It takes 20 minutes to get them up to as close to the speed of light as we get them, which, for the record, is 0.9999999999 times the speed of light. Ish. It's very close to the speed of light. I mean, they're massive particles, protons, so we'll never get them to the speed of light. And then we start steering them so that they're going, the bunches are passing through each other at different places around the ring. That's where the collisions happen. That process goes on for 10 to 12 hours of 40 million collisions a second. And then at that point, the beams after that much time are depleted. The tight bunches have dissipated to some extent because they haven't been perfectly controlled, and we've lost a lot of them to actual collisions. And at that point, when you say, well, it's not worth it, we're better off now injecting and starting again, do the 20 minutes of accelerating with brand new bunches that have more protons packed in. At that point, we dump the beam into beam dump. We're 100 meters underground, and we just kick the beam out with magnets, and it goes into lead and steel, and all just dissipates, and the energy's lost pretty quickly. Yeah. Yeah.
At the start of the talk, you were talking about gravity and not understanding the mathematics and the predictability, but not understanding the mechanism.
Yes.
And at Higgs, you're saying you understand the mechanism.
For mass.
For mass.
Yeah, yes.
I get that. But I guess my question is, what's missing? It sounds like Higgs is more satisfying or whole or complete. Gravity's not.
Mm-hmm.
Is electromagnetism, for instance, whole and complete or satisfying, or there's still a gap there?
No. So if we look, the standard model of particle physics that we have was essentially completed with the discovery of the Higgs boson. It includes electricity and magnetism, the weak force, which is responsible for radioactive decay, and the strong nuclear force that keeps the nucleus together. So those three things, I would say, we have a mechanism, predictive mechanism. They're behaving as predicted for the most part. Things are looking very good. We understand the mediating particle, the particle that's involved in those forces, right? So then gravity, we have posited a mechanism.
Right.
It's a graviton. We have not discovered the graviton. In some ways, the Higgs confuses things even more, because if I look at my mass, so it's my full mass that's involved in my, you know, gravitational attraction with the Earth. The Higgs boson is only, is it half-ish of my mass? The rest of my mass comes from energy of bonds that happen. So macroscopic human Earth masses are only partly the mass of fundamental particles. Gravity cares about mass as a whole. How does it know about something's mass? Isn't that interesting? You know, you've got both the Higgs mechanism working with fundamental particles and binding energies that are contributing to the mass of something. So how is gravity working? How is it functioning? It's a really interesting question. And I don't want to say we don't understand anything about gravity. We have an exquisite ability to model gravity. Einstein's general relativity gave us that. But we don't have a particle physics view of it. We don't have a mechanism for it. And general relativity breaks down for us when we get to tiny scales in quantum mechanics. So we, you know, it's tough.
Is that what you're particularly focused on now? I mean, you did the piece, but
yeah. So I have a couple of students who are working on Higgs boson decays. We are about to publish in a couple of months another. We've seen a new decay mode that was predicted that was rare. So we're working on that. We're also working on. Just looking for Z prime bosons. We're hunting for new particles, other new particles, because we do have a lot of mysteries beyond just gravity. we have the matter-antimatter asymmetry. We have this big problem. We have so many problems. We have dark matter, we have dark energy, which we don't understand, right? We have gravity, which we don't understand. And we have the matter-antimatter asymmetry in the universe. So if we go roll back to the Big Bang, another challenge with the Big Bang, if you look at what happens in the Big Bang, tremendous amounts of energy released, and you're producing particles, some matter particles, some antimatter particles. Now, if you look around the universe today, you would think, well, where'd all the antimatter go, right? We must have had a lot more matter produced than antimatter. We don't have any antimatter pockets that we've seen, and here we are existing. When matter and antimatter come together, they annihilate, and, you know, boom. So that is a big mystery. We can't explain the fact that we have a matter-dominated universe based on our understanding of how matter and antimatter are produced. They're not produced at exactly the same rates, but we're not even close to dialing in what we expect. So we're trying to answer that question. Gravity is way hard. Gravity is so hard. You know,
people are still studying that.
Oh yeah, I mean, theorists are studying that. Theorists are still working on problems, and we have, like, string theory would lead to a grand unified theory that includes gravity, and they're trying to make that a testable theory that we can go after and look for. They've had some successes. It's really hard. Gravity is so weak as a force that it's very, very hard for us to play with in the lab.
It's not weak when I get on the scale.
I know. But listen, just for one example, right? I mean, you know the structure of matter, how if you look at an atom, most of the mass is in the nucleus, which is this tiny spot in the center of an atom, right? And then you've got electrons that are orbiting around outside. But essentially, my hand is mostly space, and this desk is mostly space, right? What's the gravitational attraction between my hand and the desk? I mean, it's essentially non-existent. It's tiny. If you remove the desk, my hand doesn't, you know, fly away, right? And I don't get pulled into the desk standing here. There is a gravitational attraction, but it's tiny. It's electricity and magnetism that keeps my hand, mostly space, from passing through the desk. I mean, it's incredibly strong force, electricity and magnetism. Gravity just is so weak. Compared. You're right. The scale doesn't obey that law.
What did Higgs do to convince CERN to test his theory if no one believed him?
So there were, the reality is, before about 2010, I didn't think there was a Higgs boson. No way. And maybe at least 40% of us, maybe 50% of us thought, please, do not let there be a Higgs boson, right? Because that doesn't help us in terms of moving closer to a supersymmetry and a string theory and understanding gravity. And I mean, come on, a field everywhere that no one has seen, right? So I would say he didn't convince everyone, but lots of other ideas were tried, and other explanations would also require us to have higher energy. The Large Hadron Collider was gonna stamp this thing out and get people to stop talking about it or find it, right? That's what, and in some ways that's a problem, because you don't often have an experiment that has that kind of reach and can solve that level of problem. When people talk about what's the next machine that we're going to have, we don't have anything that crisp, like we're going to find it or we're going to kill it. You know what I mean? One of those two. We'll support the idea or we'll stop talking about it. I guess I'm happy to be wrong. It was super exciting. It was very exciting when we found the bump. And now, even though it's disappointing and it's hard to know how to look, where to look next, it is amazing that this idea that was so, you know, frustrating for so many people turned out to be a reflection of what's in nature.
And is it incorporated into the string theory?
So no, string theory requires 5 Higgs bosons.
Okay.
Yeah, and we're hunting for the other ones, but it would mean
they exist.
No, it would mean that this Higgs boson that we found is not actually the Higgs that Peter Higgs suggested. And you know, we talk to the theorists and they tell us, oh well, you've got to measure this quantity down to a percent level and that down to a percent level in order to be sure that it's not a supersymmetric Higgs boson. It's looking an awful lot like what was predicted in the standard model. But this is something I can say. Are there any theorists in the room? Are there no theorists?
No theoretical physicists.
No theoretical physicists anyway? Okay, maybe. So I'll say that the ideas are a little bit like cockroaches because, you know, you shine the light in one area and they go scurrying somewhere else, right? I don't mean, I love theorists. I don't mean that about them as humans, but they're very creative, you know, so yeah, there are more ideas. That's good. Well, I really appreciate the questions and your patience. I know that, yeah, it's not easy
Thank
stuff
you,
to
Sarah.
Digest on a Saturday morning.